This feels weird.
This feels weird and true.
This is my first interview.
Okay, so today's video, I thought I'd do an interview with my mother. And we're going to discuss, the first thing that we're going to discuss is kind of like how she felt being a mother and having her daughter diagnosed with Parkinson's. Maybe we can start out with, can you tell me or tell the watchers kind of like what it was like before I was diagnosed? Like, what did you notice, and when did you know it was really bad, or what did you think, that kind of thing?
I think I noticed on a visit to you that you had complained that you had was having difficulty walking. You were very tired, having difficulty to walk across the room, and I didn't quite understand what was going on. Thought maybe you'd picked up a virus or there was something wrong. I didn't think of Parkinson's necessarily, but by the time I'd got down and traveled about 2.5 hours to see you, the symptoms seemed to abate and you didn't feel that way. You were almost back to normal.
Okay, so you're really talking about, this was like a long time ago.
Yes, it was.
So that was like in Ohio, so that probably was like...
As you're 7 years here now. So,
that was a while ago. So that probably was like a good
12 years ago. 12 years ago. Yeah.
That was the first really bad incident that I had that seemed like Parkinson's. But
yeah.
I mean, looking back on it, seemed like Parkinson's.
Yeah.
So I eventually got better from that incident. I was tested a lot, but they didn't send me to a neurologist at that point. But yeah, I had symptoms very much like Parkinson's, so I'm thinking now that it was Parkinson's because I couldn't get up from the bed and just a lot of typical Parkinson things. But after a couple of years, it did go away, and at the time I was told it was stress, and but like I said, they didn't send me to a neurologist. So, can you talk about, like, recently, after I got better with that, like, right before I got diagnosed in Portland?
I think I had gone out to visit you, and you had come to meet me at the airport, and I noticed that when you were walking towards me, your gait was off, you were shuffling your feet, and I didn't quite understand that, and that... as a nurse, that made me think that you may have the shuffling of the feet, that you may have Parkinson's. That's the first time I put some kind of diagnosis to what was going on. And from there, after that, there was sort of slow progression into the Parkinson's.
You know, when the neurologist finally did say it was Parkinson's, how did you feel about that?
It was devastating because you were relatively young. You were under in your 40s, I think. And it was devastating. I felt you were in the prime of your life. You had opened a business. You were doing well. You were very active. And it was hard for me to comprehend this. I started thinking that maybe... there'd be a way around this, and maybe it was a mistake, maybe it wasn't really Parkinson's, but I didn't think of it initially as being a long-term disease. I was making excuses as to why it shouldn't be.
Okay, and I know we talked about this before, but with you being a nurse, I found that it was still difficult for you to understand fully what Parkinson's was. Do you have any thoughts to that?
Yes, with my nursing training and also my nursing experience, I did med-surg, and there were very few patients coming in with Parkinson's. The only time they really, in my memory, they really came in with Parkinson's was because they had fallen or there was a respiratory tract infection or some other diagnosis that brought them there, that then you realized they had the diagnosis. So I didn't feel that I had a lot of experience with Parkinson's clients at all.
Had you ever seen anyone that was younger with Parkinson's?
No, usually older, over 60 years of age, 60, 70.
Okay, and then, so what advice would you give to someone that has just been diagnosed with Parkinson's? Not so much the person, but more the person's family, immediate family. Like, what kind of suggestions would you give? Because it's often like kind of shocking for both people, for the person with Parkinson's that just got the diagnosis and the family.
I think to one should get involved with a diagnosis really early and really learn together with the client to seek as much information as you could about the disease. That way you can better support, that way I'm better able to support my daughter by looking at the research and all the information that's out there for Parkinson's.
Hey, have you noticed that, I don't know if this is asking you the right way, but is Parkinson's any different from what you thought it was before you had a daughter with Parkinson's?
I mean,
is the disease exactly the same like you thought it was before?
I thought it was the same. I wasn't focusing so much on the care that a Parkinson patient would need, and that how important it is to plan. I was more ignoring some of these symptoms, hoping that it would go away, and this wouldn't happen.
But do you think what you classically thought of as Parkinson's is the same disease now that you know someone with it?
A lot of the symptoms I didn't know about. Mm. I think there was such a focus on the on mobility and shaking, the tremors, that immediately if you mentioned to someone that someone had tremors, the first diagnosis they'll come up with would be Parkinson's. So there was so much emphasis on Parkinson's with mobility and tremors as such. But the more you read about Parkinson's, it's quite complex.
Hey, so what have you noticed in the, it's been like 2 years now. It doesn't feel like 2 years since I've been diagnosed,
yeah.
But what changes have you noticed, if any?
Changes sometimes in mobility, changes in the ability to continue your job, but you've not been able to continue in a full-time capacity at all. Even to work with one client can become very tiring for you. Ability to take care of your home and do cleaning and the regular activity, cleaning and shopping, you know, you try very hard, but at times that's a big effort to you.
Do you notice any difference in how people treat me in the public? Or people that know me?
The people that seem to know you closely seem to be acceptable of what's going on with you, not that they necessarily understand, but I haven't been sensitive to people treating you differently necessarily. They might observe you, they might look at you and wonder, with such a young person, what's really wrong, and are they going to confuse it with some mental health problem, thinking as you've known.
What about any personality changes? Have you noticed any?
with communication, sometimes you have a hard time when you're communicating with someone, including me, and I am not understanding what you're saying and asking you to repeat what you're saying because your voice tone may be very soft and I'm not really understanding what you're saying, that can irritate you a bit.
And like I've noticed, like, it kind of comes and goes, the problems I have in my throat. Have you noticed that?
Yeah. I think when you are not feeling well, then the problems with your throat seem to be worst.
And what about specific other things with personality?
You seem to be less joyous at times. A disappointment in life as to what will happen next and how much you're going to be able to take care of yourself independently. That's a big concern of yours because I'm getting older and it may be difficult for me to care for you and vice versa. So that's a whole issue that sometimes we don't discuss because it's a tough subject.
And is there anything else you can think of that you want to tell people right now? Is there not a lot of videos with interviews on people with young onset Parkinson's and their parents and how their parents feel about their, you know, I guess a parent usually thinks they might get Parkinson's, not their,
yeah.
Not their daughter or son.
Yes. I think to be supportive and to be more supportive of the person, of the child, and maybe to start planning for the future early, much earlier. And
well, do you think it's that's good advice. I wonder if it's any different though, what you're saying, because I don't have the support of a spouse and children.
Mm. Yes.
I wonder if I had a spouse and children, if that would be different. What do you think?
I think it would be different because it's with your spouse and child is a family that you live in quite closely with. You see them a lot more hours than you'll probably see me in any given day. And
So probably the parent wouldn't be as much involved in
the parent may not be planning. So may not be so very involved. But would it on the other hand, would it affect the patient because you feel a sense of disappointment because you can't do everything and you're not able to fully take on the role of a mother as your condition deteriorates?
So really what you're saying, really, I mean, for an odd situation, because I don't have a spouse or children, like you would be the next person that would be kind of like not responsible for me but have a sense of responsibility. So I guess it would be the same thing if that wasn't the situation for people that are listening. It sort of would be the same as far as their spouse.
Yeah.
The spouse would,
yes.
Or their, well, their children probably would be young, so it probably would be the spouse,
yes,
that would,
yes,
feel.
Yes. And I think the more that the family could, or friends could involve that person in their lives and don't take it for granted that they may not want to go somewhere or do something because they're not able to, at least to involve them. It's the communication is important too, to be able to talk to a friend or talk to someone else and not to be, as the disease progresses, not be to be at home all day long to get involved in different things.
How do you feel about the ups and downs of the disease? Like, what I've noticed is that, you know, I always am sick every day with something. Mostly, like, the pain really affects me. But, like, the motion things, like, a lot of the things aren't really apparent to a stranger. And then slowly I think you've learned that, you know, there are big ups and downs, and especially if I get stressed out or I get the flu, then I go through a really bad period. Any comments about that? I'm just asking you if there's comments maybe to make someone that doesn't know someone with Parkinson's understand that there are fluctuations.
I think with the fluctuations, I would notice sometimes there's a difference in the, maybe a difference in the, not the attitude, in probably you not wanting to communicate much. It's like maybe you don't want to go out or you don't want to do something, and sometimes it becomes a little bit difficult for me because then I'm not too sure how I'm going to go about getting around it as such. I guess as a mother, I was always very present. I worked a full-time job, but I always felt that coupled with my nursing, when something came up, I was always able to fix it. In one way or the other, I can help to fix it, whether it's financial, whether it's going to visit you or your sister, or working out, maybe there's a medical diagnosis and we need to go see a specialist. So I was always in that fix-it mode. And whatever was wrong was only temporary, not permanent. So now it's hard to know that I'm getting older and I may not be physically able to help trying to fix things as such. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yes, yes.
Okay, I'm gonna end the session now, but thank you for being on video. I know you were kind of apprehensive about being on video, so I'd like to thank you for sharing that information with people.